little bit of both.
Yeah. When you say, I don't know, say, you know, good question. Glad you brought it up. Oh, you know, you must have asked that for a reason. Ben did that before. It's a good way to give yourself time. Sometimes you need time to think of an answer, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you turn it around on it. Why? You know, when I go to a meeting, sometimes a company will ask me to come to a meeting because they need help in sales. And nothing's more intimidating than going in an office and there's this long table with all these people dressed really nice and everything like that. What do you think is the first thing your Uncle Claude says? Anybody? What do you think I say? I walk in the meeting. It's all these people on the long table. What's the, it's a little intimidating.
Okay. Why am I here today?
Yeah. Who said that?
Actually, I said it to somebody else.
I said it too.
Why am I here today? Kate, could you guys help me out? What am I doing here? What's the problem? What's the biggest challenge? What would you like to change in your company sales or marketing? Can you help me out? And make sure, just tell me and I'll write some notes down here. And so you turn it right around. You make everybody else in the room do the work for you.
And then it becomes a feeding frenzy of who raises their hand first.
Yeah. Yeah. And you turn it around. So you don't have to just stand there. So in the same thing with a prospect, why are you selling that home? Oscar, turn on your video, man. iPhone, turn on your video.
It's like, let's get to the nitty gritty why I'm here instead of me making a boring presentation to you.
Why am I here? I had a prospect today I was talking to. Had a lot of questions, okay? And this was the kind of person, you ever get somebody who wants to stay on the phone with you an hour or longer? And I said to this person, why am I here? What would you like to see happen? If you could find a solution to your problem, it was a real estate issue. If you could find a solution to your problem, would you and I be able to do business today? Do you have the money for us to do business today? And she said she didn't have the money. What do you think I did next?
Sent her your free book and talk to you later.
Yeah, I got off politely. It's over. Oh, but I have a whole bunch of questions, Ben. I still have a lot of questions, even though I don't have any money.
Yeah. And you know, if I were you, I would seek professional expertise on it. Would you like to do that?
I don't have the money to pay them either.
Okay, well.
Would you like me to coach you?
So why are we talking today?
Yeah. You're going to get people and they're going to keep you on the phone for a long, long time asking a lot of questions. And I always go back to the premise that, can we do business? Is it practical? Are they motivated enough? And then the money question. Always talk about the money, buying or selling or negotiating terms. When can we do that? In the first phone call.
Can you elaborate more on that? Like, you know, letting them off the hook when they tell you about the money?
Dave, it sounds to me like right now doing business for us today is not comfortable in your budget. I get that. Thank you for sharing, being so transparent about your situation. It sounds to me like it's over, but I love it. I really appreciate you calling me. I have your email. I'm going to send you a little gift. Okay.
Okay.
And I'm going to say goodbye.
But wait a minute. I have some questions for you.
Oh, good. Well, you know what you might want to do? Send me an email. And if I have time later in the week, I'll try to answer some of your questions. Okay. If you could keep them very short and succinct. And it was a pleasure to meet with you and speak with you. And if your budget or financial situation changes, make sure you touch base with me again. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.
So I can't ask you any questions without sending you a check?
Yes.
Wow. Really?
I wasn't stuttering.
I'm just feeding into it more.
You're going to get people in many situations where they're going to keep you on the phone, pick your brain, and you have nothing to show for it. Wouldn't you rather speak to somebody, a prospect, where you have at least a possibility of doing a deal today? I'm just sharing with
you. So saying something like, you know, from what you're telling me, I can't give you a simple answer to solve your problem.
Yeah. I'll just say, it's over. Bye-bye. That's all.
Boy, you act a lot more friendly on your videos.
you're probably right. I got to switch to decaf or something like that. Too much caffeine. Listen, sir. It was. I got your email. I'm sending you a little gift. I'm going now. Bye bye. Have a nice day. Click.
So you don't. I don't even know how much you charge.
Doesn't matter. You couldn't afford it anyway.
True.
I mean, see, you're allowed to get off the phone. You have rights in the negotiating process. So when should you talk about money? Beginning, middle, or end of the conversation?
Up front,
always up front. If there was a way to solve your problem, if there was a way to help you do the purchase of your home or get into a home, you mind if we talk about money for a minute? Is that all right?
What do you mean?
I said, do you mind if we talk about money? You're interested in buying my house, sir. Are you pre-qualified already through a bank and you have a letter of acceptance?
Not yet, but I'm looking around.
Okay. Also, how much would your budget allow you to put down for this lease purchase property today?
How much do I need?
Usually we like to get close to 10%. That would be $18,000. That's a lot of money. Is that comfortable for you today?
That's a little higher than I expected.
Which means?
Can you do it for maybe five?
No, that's too big a drop. You have the 5,000 today? I'm just curious, sir.
Yeah, I have five, but I don't have 18.
And what's the source of that five, by the way?
Cash.
Oh, okay. So you have that in your mattress and a bank account or something like that?
Yeah.
Okay. See, off the role play. What am I doing? Even though I might negotiate a deal, but I want to find out, does he have the money? Does he have it today? And what is the source of that money? Because sometimes people say they have money and you find out that they're waiting for a loan approval or a new credit card or a relative they're trying to borrow it from. You better find out what's the source of that money and when is it available to do a deal. What happens if you do a real estate deal with somebody? You sign a contract, you take a token amount of money thinking you're going to get the rest soon, and they don't come across with the money because you didn't get a strong enough commitment of the source of the money and when you're going to get paid. What happens? They just locked up your property, didn't they, with a contract?
Yeah. Time is money.
Absolutely. Yeah. Hi, Lynn. Good to see you again.
Would you continue on and try to get them to commit to an extra $500 a month to make up the difference, or is it over?
It's a good question. The answer is it depends. If it's a deal, what happens if this is a deal and the clock is ticking for me and I'm almost out of time to do this deal? What happens if I really need the money badly and I'm not getting a lot of phone calls? I'm desperate.
I'll tell you, Claude, I have a good income. I can afford a good payment, but I've only been able to save up $5,000 at this point.
Okay.
So if you can work something out with me in the payment, or do you want me to just check back with you and when I come up with more money?
Well, would you mind could I ask you two or three different, could I ask you two or three questions real quick? And then we'll find out if we can do business today. Is that all right with you?
Sure.
Okay. And if we can do business, great. If not, we'll call it a day. Are you employed right now, sir?
Yes.
Okay. And you've been at your job how long?
10 years.
10 years. That's great. And credit, in terms of credit, what would you think your credit score is right now? Do you have a clue?
About 640.
Okay.
640. No, I'm sorry. I'm about 700.
Okay. Now you, I wanted, I forgot how much I said, 18,000. And you want 5,000 down and the payments are 500 a month. Could you put 7,500 down and 1,000 a month?
That's like I said, I don't have the extra 2,500 at okay. this moment.
You don't have a credit card or something.
Could we maybe do an extra 500 a month in the payment?
You're right. The mint is 500 and that would be 1,000 a month. So you could do 5,000 down and 1,000 a month, correct?
That I can do.
Okay. And is there someone in your family who could co-sign with on this transaction just to be a guarantor of your payments?
Of the 1,000 a month or the extra 2,500?
I don't know what...
You asked for 7,500 and I only have five.
Yeah. You're going to pay 1,000 a month, 5,000 down. Okay. For towards a $7,500 deposit option consideration. And can you get a co-signer?
Why do I need one? I have a 700 FICO score and I have a good job with decent income.
Then why can't you borrow the rest of the money that we need up front?
My credit cards are a little maxed out at the moment because of the pandemic.
Okay, boo-hoo. Last time, sir. Is there anybody in your family who thinks enough of you to co-sign and take on the adjoining responsibility?
That I'll have to get back to you on.
I'll talk to you later. Have a nice day.
Got it.
This is a guy who's going to move in the property or do a deal with me, and what's going to happen 2-3 months later?
Excuses,
boo-hoo. Oh, Claude, you know, my wife's never seen Tijuana, Mexico, and, you know, we planned this trip, and and they're going to give you all that stuff, and who's going to suffer? And now you've got somebody in your property or a situation you're stuck with. You have to be very careful in real estate. Or anything.
Plus you came down from 18. You came down 8 to 18 to 7,500.
Yeah, and you still couldn't do the deal.
Yeah,
it's not. You don't have one person in your family or friends or anybody. And maybe even now, ask Alan. He'll co-sign for you. Go ahead, Dave.
Hey, Al, buddy, you got 2,500 you can lend me?
That's a good question. Suppose I did. What would you say to me next?
I'll give you 3,000 back.
Oh, sounds too good to be true. What's the catch?
Nothing. I'm just trying to get into this house, and the guy needs an extra 2,500 more than I have. And you're a good friend of mine. I've always paid you back on time, but I'll give you a little extra, you know, for helping me out.
Oh, okay. Well, you're a gentleman, Dave. I mean, could you tell me more about the house? I mean, this isn't in a bad neighborhood, is it?
Okay, I'm moving into it.
Okay, let's
not an investment.
Let's wind this up in 60 seconds. I don't want this to be the world's longest role play.
Can you help me or not?
Okay, I mean,
I can pay you back in about 3 months.
3 months. I mean, I have this other investment opportunity where I can double. I mean, we couldn't. If I could do this today, and I told you that I needed to get 3,500 back, is that something that you'd be comfortable with, or maybe not? And it's okay to say no too.
Yeah, that's gonna stretch me too far.
Okay. I mean, I guess you don't really need to move in the house then, Dave, right?
I got to do what I got to do, but I can't go over my limit. But I appreciate it, so I'll give Ben a call next. Thanks for help. Thanks for talking to me.
Bye bye.
Boom. Over. God, I was like pulling teeth without Novocaine.
I thought you were a good friend, man.
Yeah.
Okay, it's let's not cold.
I'm gonna call Helen. I'm gonna call Helen. She's an easy sell.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, David, you're selling a hot coal walking part. You're selling a hot coal walking for Anthony Robbins. Okay, so close. Go ahead and close me.
Wow, that one you're pushing me. I wouldn't even know how to. What's the benefit of that besides burn cream?
Well, what if you were Anthony Robbins has created a whole business around cold walking. He has signed up probably tens of thousands of people at $5,000 or more to walk on hot coals. How does he do that? What's the emotion he pulls out for that?
Overcoming fear, probably.
Oh, let's find. Okay. So do you
if
think
you can do that? You can do anything.
Okay. Go ahead. Sell. Go ahead. Alan, go ahead and sell me. Hello, insecure Claude here. Hello.
Hey, Claude. Oh, sorry. I got to take this. Skip me.
Oh, that was fast. Who wants to go next? Ben, go ahead. You're selling me the Anthony Robbins $5,000 coal walking.
Insecure Claude, it's Ben Hyde getting back to you on the coal walking. How are you?
Well, not so good. I just had to walk my five chihuahuas, and it's raining outside and everything. And my wife wants to go to our high school reunion in Arkansas, you know, right. in March. It's been a rotten day.
All right. Well, I don't want to make it any more rotten than it is. So why are we talking today about coal walking?
I don't know. You called me.
I'm getting back to you. Anyway,
I must have.
Well, you're familiar with Anthony and what we do.
Big fan. I've read all of his books and everything like that.
Right. And we'd certainly like to share the experience with you and see you grow and benefit. What have you done in terms of personal growth, similar to this?
I take a lot of vitamins.
Yeah, and how are the results?
I'm still 5'8". That's it.
Okay, well we're gonna show you amazing growth, not in physical height, but in every other area of your life, spiritually, psychologically, and quite often financially.
And
that's a fact. So what I'd like to do is get you going today. We have some events coming up at the end of the month. 24th through the 29th. And I think we've got two seminars. Can we sign you up?
I'll think about it.
What's to think about?
I don't know. I just, you got to off the role play. What's the emotion you got to bring out of me?
Yeah.
Hey, Claude, what's your biggest challenge?
Yeah.
What's holding you back from getting what you want in life?
Go ahead, Dave.
Are you afraid of it? What are you afraid of?
Not much.
So what's holding you back from getting to where you want to be from where you are right now?
I don't, you know, it's been the weather has been so bad here. It's raining and my wife doesn't understand me and my boss is horrible.
But you said you wanted to be a millionaire real estate investor. How are you going to do that if you're just going to wallow in your cry on your chihuahuas?
Wow. So what's your solution?
We have a program that will break you free of all the things that are holding you back and dig deep into finding out what your challenges are and, you know, what the hidden secrets that are in your mind that are keeping you blocking you from, you know, getting ahead in life. And at the end of this thing, we do a fire walk, which is an amazing achievement. If you can get through the gauntlet of the fire walk, you can overcome anything.
I have tender feet though. I mean, that sounds dangerous.
So it doesn't sound like you're ready to move forward and get to where you want to be in life, do you?
Well, are there any guarantees?
If you don't walk fast, you might get a blister.
Okay.
Guarantee we have burn cream at the end of the walk.
Yeah, that was a tough one. Let's do another one here. What the takeaway of this is, when you're selling personal, Anthony Robbins sells personal achievement, growth. I heard you guys, you and Ben, both touched on growth, personal achievement, and everything. I would have loved to, you know, maybe a story, say, you know what, we've been doing this for years. This helps you to overcome blockages, things that are holding you back. I heard a little bit of that from you, Dave. You know, imagine for a moment you can accomplish this. What else could you, after you have that little success step, could you go to the next one and the one after that? Something like that. It's hard. It's a hard sell, isn't it? Maybe we got to call somebody, call up Anthony Robbins and find out how they sell firewalks. Okay.
I always forget about the imagine for a moment.
Oh yeah. Imagine. Why do we use that word imagine?
Takes them to another place.
Yeah.
Where they want to be.
Yeah. That nice, that little daydreaming place that you go into and you see yourself there and accomplishing something. Okay, somebody sell, Lynn, you want to take a shot at this? You want to take a shot at a role play here?
What?
Sell me a $500 Kobe steak dinner.
Oh, I'm a newbie at this. So Claude, do you like,
excellent.
Do you like fancy restaurants or do you like McDonald's?
You know, I'm kind of a mac and cheese kind of guy.
Oh, yeah. I've been to some, your wife. Is there anything you've done to your wife lately that you could probably, you know, justify taking her out for a nice dinner?
Well, that's kind of a personal question. let's see. Well, it's our wedding. Our wedding anniversary on the 29th.
Oh, well, have you ever experienced Kobe beef? It's nothing like any beef you've ever tried.
No, I haven't. Is that like a steak or something?
It's the best way to eat it, but yeah, it's very smooth. I don't know anything about Kobe beef, but it has no fat in it. Very tender.
There's a lot of fat in a Kobe steak. That's why it tastes so good.
Okay, there's a lot of fat. It still cuts like butter. Like you won't, it's like nothing. Imagine for a minute eating butter that tastes like steak. I don't know. Okay. Like imagine something.
Okay. You're on the right track. Do you like steak? Do you like nice restaurants? Could you imagine yourself there? Could you imagine the most delicious steak you ever had? These are cows, if you knew a little bit about it. They're cows from Japan, basically, and they feed them beer all day long and they give them hand massages. So it's true. Go onto YouTube and look it up.
Gotta put that juicy bite in your mouth.
Oh yeah. Here's one. Okay, this is this one is a little controversial. I'm Elon Musk, and you want me to turn on Starlink. Okay. This just happened, by the way. Did you hear that? Did anybody hear about this? Zelensky called up Elon Musk, and he said, you know, the Russians have shut off all our internet and everything. Can you turn on your new state-of-the-art satellite system? What do you think he said? What do you think he said to him to get him to turn on a system that nobody in the world has used yet? What do you think he said to him? Do you think he made it emotional?
Yes.
You will save lives.
There's children dying.
Yeah. Could you, what do you think he said? Go ahead. Hello, Elon Musk here.
Cricket.
I need your help.
Go ahead, Helen.
We need your help.
In what way?
We are suffering. We are dying. We are being under attack.
Okay. you gotta ask me. You need communication right now, and you know I have something brand new to turn on the internet and anywhere in the world, but I haven't used it yet, and you need communication.
Can you help us? We're all going to be appreciated. You're going to save a lot of lives, a lot of kids, a lot of women. You're going to save a lot of people, and we'll pray for you for the rest of our life.
Gee, I'd like to help you, but it's a brand new system. We haven't even tested it yet or anything.
We are ready for everything. We need to save lives, so we are ready for any risk possible.
I can try.
Please try hard. We need you. Okay. We need your help as soon as possible, even now.
Okay, it's on. Click. I just turned it on. Hey, actually, I don't know the context of the conversation, but that's what happened. He called him up. I'm sure it was an emotional request, and he turned on. He has these little hundreds of these little satellites around the Earth, little small satellites, so that anyone in the world can someday have internet, no matter where they live. And he turned it on specially for Ukraine. I thought that was really a wonderful thing.
It is.
Absolutely. Hello, Luke Quinnall.
Hey, how's it going?
I'm good, good. Luke Quinnall, role play. You need to see Warren Buffett because you have a brilliant, you have something wonderful to sell, but I'm the secretary who guards him, so nobody can just walk in.
Okay, so I got to go see Warren Buffett because what?
You got to see Warren Buffett, but I'm his secretary. I don't anybody get through to Warren Buffett. You say, how are you going to get past me?
Oh, gosh, that's a tough one.
That's a tough one, huh?
That's a tough one. So you're secretary.
How do you get past the guardian at the gate?
Mr. Diamond, I don't know.
Hello, Warren Buffett's office. This is Claude. Hey.
Claude, it's Dan. Is Warren available for lunch?
Yeah. Who's Lou?
Who's doing this? Ben or Lou?
Is that Jasso or me?
Yeah. Go ahead.
Ben, oh, yeah. Hey, no, it's not available for us. Hey, Claude, this is Lou. Mr. Buffett and I have a lunch appointment today. Can I speak to him today?
I don't see you on his schedule.
Yeah, well, you know, he called me up just a few minutes ago, told me to talk to you.
Oh, now, I know when we role play, we're allowed a certain amount of license to.
Yeah, I know. I lied there, so.
You're lying, yes.
So.
Okay, let's say she lets you in.
Okay.
You know, who are you? I never heard of you before. What luncheon appointment? You lied. Did you lie to my secretary to get in here?
I did, sir. So, I don't know. Why are we here? I don't even know why we're doing this. Why are we talking today?
I don't know. You barged in my office. You lied to get in here, and you something about taking me out to lunch.
Huh? I'll take you out to lunch.
What's this all about? What do you really want?
You like cheeseburgers, Claude?
Yeah.
What's the way? Seriously, the point of this exercise is, what's something you could say to the guardian at the gate to get past that person? To see someone you really want, whether it's Warren Buffett, Elon Musk.
That I have something which is gonna bring a lot of benefit for Warren Buffett. I have something for him.
Well, why don't you just leave your materials here or leave a message on the voicemail and I'll see that he gets it. Thank you.
Hey, Claude, I know Mr. Buffett thinks a lot about you. You've been with him for a long time, I'm sure. If you can put me through to Warren, I've got something to show him. And if you'll help me out, I'll give you the credit for it, that you had this great idea to contact this guy. and it'll lift you up the pedestal a little bit higher. I don't know. I'm throwing something at
you. Okay. This is a tough one.
I'm trying to stroke you, but I don't know what to
say. This is a real hard, tough one. Everybody give up?
No, Claude, imagine you could be the accessory to a profit-making deal that Mr. Buffett never knew about right now. What do you think he'll say about you, and where would that put you in your career?
He'll probably fire me because I let you in. Mr. Buffett is very busy. He only takes appointments with people who he has a relationship with. Why don't you just leave your card? Thank you. Leave your business card, and I'll see he gets it. Thank you.
Well, you're a tough secretary.
I know.
I am. Well, let me ask you, do you think somebody who's prominent, well-known, do you think he gets a lot of crazy people call him or want to see him and speak to him?
Yes.
Okay. So you gotta, this involves creativity. Okay, who wants to beat me up now? Who wants to be the secretary? Go ahead, Lou, Dave, somebody be the Warren Buffett secretary.
Ring, ring.
Say hello, Warren Buffett.
Hello. Go ahead. Hello, Berkshire Hathaway.
Yeah, hi. Would you tell Warren Claude's here? I want to take him out to lunch. I want to see if he's available. I'm in town. I want to see if he's available for lunch today.
Hey, I appreciate the offer, but Mr. Buffett is already.
Well, it wasn't to you, sir. It was to Mr. Buffett. It was to Warren.
I know, and I have his calendar in front of me, and he's booked. Thank you.
Well, just tell him it's Claude on the phone, and I'm in town. I wanted to see if he's free for lunch. Would you do that small favor for me?
Absolutely. I'll take that.
Thank you very much. I'll tell Warren you're doing a great job. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Boom. Put me through. Boom. Is it okay to invite people to lunch or something like that?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. I have one client. He was on our group call a couple months ago. He goes to CEO. He's in New York City. And he goes to the offices of CEOs when it's a really nasty rainy day with a bunch of brand new umbrellas. And he goes to the office and says, hi, is Mr. Buffett in? I have this umbrella for him. It's a little gift. It's raining outside. I thought maybe he could use an umbrella. Here's one for you too, by the way, Mr. Secretary. Sure. It actually works.
Is this the commercial guy?
Yeah. Aaron Schreier.
You got to get him back on a Monday.
Oh, yeah. I got to get him back. He's got another one, too. He waits for Monday morning, and he goes to these offices with bagels and coffee. He'll deliver bagels and coffee in the morning. Nobody says no to bagels and coffee.
That's true.
No. Not in New York, anyway. That in the off. Who wants to sell me?
What does he do when he shows up with the bagels and coffee? What's the objective besides bringing them a gift? Just being memorable at that moment. So if he calls back another time,
he goes.
Hey,
it's me, Aaron.
Remember me? I brought the bagels and cream cheese.
He goes in there right there. I have a gift for your CEO, for your sales staff, for your sales manager. He goes in. He takes a risk for $30-$40. To get in to see people, he's that creative. Umbrellas, cupcakes, bagels and coffee. You know, it's hard to see people when you're starting from nowhere, when you don't have a reference or anything. It's sometimes you got to be a little creative, a little daring.
So he's not trying to do something necessarily at that moment. He's just trying to put his toe in the doorway.
He's trying to get into something. Somebody somewhere that's almost impossible. So he does something completely off the wall. Let's do a new one, but we're running out of time. Who wants to sell me a remote cabin in the woods? How would you make that emotional? Lou, you want another shot?
A remote cabin in the woods?
Yes, I'm a stressed out attorney. And you're selling, you have this beautiful little cabin in the woods, and you need to sell it to me. What kind of emotions would you sell to someone who's in a very high stressful job? what would you bring up?
Relaxation, peace and quiet.
Escape,
quiet. Yeah. No phone call. You can't get phone calls. Maybe there's no cell tower there. It's very remote. Okay. And what kind of, how would you use the five senses with that person? Oh, could you smell? Oh, the pine trees. Oh, that smell out there. And then on a cold night, you can start a fireplace and you've got this great little wood stove and you can fry bacon and eggs on it at night and stuff like that. That's what I'm trying to, I want you to make it romantic. I want you to use the five senses. I want you to create a visual in my mind and close me in one phone call. You can do this. Hi, hello, this is Claude, the stressed out attorney. Hello.
Hi, Claude.
I'm really stressed.
Hey, Claude, this is Lou Canole. Hey, are you still interested in that that property out in the woods? It's you mentioned that you were interested in that.
I need to get away. I'm working 8 days a week. I'm working 13, 14 hours a day. My blood pressure's going up. I'm yelling at people. So I'm looking for something that's really secluded.
Yeah.
You don't have anything like, you're a real estate agent or? Or who are you?
No, not a real estate agent. I am an investor. I pick up properties but you had mentioned that you were, I know you're really stressed out, and that's really, I'm really,
oh sorry, yeah, I'm, oh,
you know, I mean, you must be like going nuts and you know, with all that pressure. I mean, you're an attorney, right? And like, what do you do? I mean, as an attorney, are you like with,
I defend worthless criminals all day long.
Yeah, you know, I can understand that. I can understand that. Look, you know, just imagine this for a moment, Claude. I mean, you have this, you can take a break from all of that in a nice quiet setting with beautiful vistas. You can smell the pine trees, you can hear the birds chirping. You know, maybe one day you could be cooking eggs and frying bacon on out in the woods somewhere. You know, don't have to deal with any phone calls anymore. Oh, you know,
how come I can't deal with phone calls? What if one of my clients wants to reach me?
Do you want to make that place a little bit more? I thought you wanted peace and quiet for a little bit.
I really do. I'm looking for a place that has no cell service.
And what if this place has one? What would happen?
I really want to I want a place that can totally get away and forget about work and relax.
Okay. All right.
And I can go fishing and take hike, long quiet hikes.
Oh yeah, you know, I can understand that. I mean, I can, there's a little fishing brook out there where you can go fishing. Can you imagine that? You know, fresh water coming down the stream and fish just jumping and you were able to catch them. I mean, can you see that? I mean, imagine what would happen if you could do that, if you could do all that.
I think I'd want to do that. Are there any other cabins around or people? I want to be secluded.
No, this is a secluded area. Easy to get to, not too easy. I mean, we don't want people coming up the street. I mean, that's something that, you could take a look at. I mean, just take a look at it. See if there's something you want to do.
I want to make a decision today.
All right. Let's do this. Why don't we? What are we looking? I don't know. I'm lost here now.
Just close me. You're working too hard at this. What did I just say? Here's the old joke. Can you accept yes as an answer?
Yeah. You know, hey, what? Claude, what are you doing this weekend?
I was going to just stay in the office and do a lot of paperwork.
Why don't we do this? Why don't I give you the keys to the cabin? It's vacant right now. Why don't you take your wife, take the dog, go up there for the weekend, test it out, see the lake, take a walk through the woods, make a fire, sit on the couch, cozy up, make some hot chocolate, maybe barbecue, a steak, smell the nature around, the flowers, the pine, listen to the birds,
the bear
and just try it. Just try it, you know, try it out for the weekend. And then tell me, we'll talk on Monday. Let's make a time to talk on Monday. And when we talk, you can tell me if this is a good fit for you.
Okay. Oh, it's Monday now. Hey, Dave, the place was great. I loved it.
You got to experience everything that was up there, huh? Was it nice and quiet?
Beautiful. Oh, it was perfect. I loved it. My wife loves it.
Okay, great. So I sent you over the material on the place, the price and everything. Where do you see us going from here? What would you say to me next?
I'm very interested.
Okay. Do you want to open up paperwork on it and get started?
What does that mean?
I need 10,000 down, and we'll work out. I own it free and clear, so I can even carry the paper if you want, or you can get financing on it.
Okay. Off the role play. Wouldn't you rather have cash?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've never sold a cabin in the woods. Sorry.
Oh, okay. Okay. Sell me. Somebody close me. Close me. Who wants to close me? Somebody else. Joseph and Ellen, close me. I'm sorry.
So if you experience and everything is okay for you, would you like to continue and get it now?
Absolutely. What's the price again?
It's approximately $250,000, but if you like it, it's $249,000.
It's okay. My wife loves it. My kids do. It's just beautiful. Is that the best? Is that the best price you can do though? Only $1,000 discount.
How would you pay? Cash?
I can give you all cash, and I can close before St. Patrick's Day.
Oh, okay. In this case, it's $235 for you.
How about $225, and you got a deal?
Never split the difference.
Okay, I'm a nice guy, so let's meet me in the middle, like $230. Because I do have interest in this, but you experienced it already, and if you like it, I would love you to have it.
$225, you want $230. How about the closing costs? Can you take care of that? Can you take care of the closing costs, and you got a deal at $230?
We'll split in half, closing cost.
Maybe I should think about this.
You are not allowed to think. Your wife likes it, your dog likes it. So you had beautiful time over there. So why do you need to think about it? Would you regret later about that if you miss it?
Okay, you, good point. Give him a round, that was good. He said your wife likes it.
You're gonna lose this cabin for $2,500?
$250,000, I thought it was.
No, I mean, I mean the difference on the closing cost.
Oh, whatever. Listen, this is what people do. Do people ask, when you negotiate with somebody and they're highly motivated and their wife loves the cabin, do you have to drop your price a lot?
No. Really.
All right. If they're not that motivated, but you need to sell it because you owe taxes or something.
Redo that closing and you close.
No,
you're the seller.
I think Joseph did it perfect. I think Joseph did it great.
Thank you.
I that was great. You brought up, look, your wife likes it. You were just up there. You had a beautiful weekend and everything. You told me you were getting stressed and you needed a place to get away. Isn't this, the money's not a question. You make a great living. Buy it. Treat yourself wonderful and your family. Can we move forward today? Because I think this is exactly what you needed. Think of how many more years you'll add to your life. Think of the good memories you'll create for your children and your wife getting away on this weekend. How important, on a 1 through 10, how important is creating memories, being together with the family, and taking care of your health? On a 1 through 10, 10 meaning it's important.
11.
Let's do, I've made a decision, Helen. You and Joe are gonna buy this cabin today.
Yeah, that's good. As a bonus, we can add some few wolves and bears around. So if you want.
Listen, once you buy it, you can do whatever you want. This is just, sometimes selling is just being a good listener and listening to what people have to say. Absolutely. Who has anybody else have a role play? Otherwise, I'll go down my list. What's the toughest stall or objection or craziest question you ever heard from a prospect? Ben, you talk to people every day. What's one of the hardest or toughest people you've ever dealt with?
I can get these for less money. I've seen them over here. I've seen them over there.
That's a good objection. How do you deal with it? Same thing. Are we talking apples and apples here?
Exactly. Let's be sure we're not comparing apples to apples.
Well, there's a lot of other people that have a lot cheaper investment coins than you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you want $5,000?
I in fact do. And there's a reason for that. What offers do you, what have you been offered? Do you have anything in writing?
Well, I had this one company, they called me up from some other country and they said, if I did a wire transfer, I could get it for almost $1,000 less than you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, we charge the $1,000 difference. It could very likely be because my company has a better business rating of A++. And we are also a accredited member of the United States Mint, which is a very difficult task. So we work very hard. We have to work very hard and honor the requests and the claims of our clients, which is verified. If we ever chose not to do that, if we were to be disreputable, the Mint would surely cancel us. We spend well into seven figures with them each and every year. And we guarantee everything we do. I'm prepared to put your offer in writing momentarily.
How about you incorporate a little fear? Claude, do you really want to send money to a company you've never done
business
with?
That's where I was going next. Let me tell you a story.
Use the fear. Go ahead.
There's a lot of fraud and a lot of counterfeit going on out there. Again, we have, I will substantiate everything I'm presenting to you here. I had a poor gentleman recently, had a $100,000 collection. They said, send it to me. They're in the Philippines. We're going to take a look at it and we will issue you funds. Guess what? He sent it to them. They sent him counterfeit paperwork. You know the rest of the story, Claude.
Wow. So you mean this company, you mean I might be taking a risk here?
You are a high income person. And that's why we're speaking. The company had me reach out to you on this offering for a reason. You know what happens, Todd. You know who we are. I think you know the mentality that we bring to all of our transactions.
Go ahead, Helen.
Ben, it seems to me it's a good idea to invent another cloud strategy. Why you don't want to work with them? Why you're not buying from them? They're much cheaper. Why you don't want to?
I'm not going to spill all my marbles at once. We're going to see where it goes. I'll take them out one at a time.
Ask me why I didn't do business with this other company already. Go ahead.
So, Claire, why haven't you gone with them? What's holding you back?
Well, I'm a little bit nervous. I've been ripped off before. Mm-hmm. They're not in the United States. They're in
I hear that story. I hear that story more than 50% of the time. I don't know when you last transacted. The industry has become, there's too many players out there giving this industry a black eye. And I'm sure that you got scorched.
Step on my toes a little, Claude. You're too smart. You're too smart to invest in an unknown company, you know, just to save a few bucks when you can work with a legitimate, authorized, licensed company that has a guarantee that's been in business since Abraham Lincoln. Whatever. A challenge. Hit my common sense button. Hit me hard, Claude. You really want to take a risk and do business with an unknown company and a.
Claude, it's I'm not going to sugarcoat this and waste time. Claude, you've been ripped off before. You're thinking about doing business with a foreign company outside the United States. You know us; our reputation speaks for itself. Why? Same thing. You're going to get the same results if you go down that road. I'll get you on the phone with our CEO right now. We'll go live. We'll go on Zoom. You got a minute? Can you get on Zoom?
Sure.
Things are going fast. I got 10 of them left. We had 20 yesterday.
A little scarcity. Okay, you just threw in there. Sometimes when you get people, gee, how come when you negotiate with somebody and they bring up competition with a lower price, mm-hmm. what do you need to create in that person emotionally? Doubt. Right?
And value.
Or just say, why didn't you buy it? Hey, they're a lot cheaper than me. Why didn't you just go ahead and buy it? Why do you think people pay us more money for our product than these people you mentioned? Take a guess. You're a smart young man. Go ahead. You're basically putting the nexus, the stress back on the prospect. And they're saying, well, maybe you offer a better guarantee, you have better service, something like you offer a better product or something. There has to be an advantage that you have over somebody else, mm-hmm. whether it's you're a legitimate company or you make a better product or something. You have sometimes, I think we argue money a lot of times with people when we don't have to justify a higher price. Why do people buy a Mercedes versus a Hyundai?
I don't know anything about the coin industry, but if he also
doesn't matter.
If he also said to you, you know, Claude, if you do this deal and there comes a time you need to liquidate the asset, we have a buyback guarantee and we can put it in writing. What percentage we'll pay you to take these off your hands and liquidate them if you should need the money right away.
Okay. How about this? Last role play before we run out of time. You have you're a salesman in a Cadillac dealership. You sell very expensive cars, and I drive up to your dealership in a 15-year-old Ford pickup truck, and you ask me what kind of business I'm in. Go ahead. Hi, these are beautiful cars.
Who's doing it? Me?
Go ahead. You can do it.
Hey, these are great cars. Oh, wait, I'm the salesman and you're the customer.
You're the salesman.
Okay. How you doing today?
I got
these are beautiful, aren't they?
Yeah, these are great cars. You know, I'm just looking.
Okay. Can you see yourself driving one of these?
Oh, no. Gosh. I mean, my pickup truck still runs.
That's great. Looks like you're really loyal to your Ford truck.
It's a nice truck. It still runs. It burns a little gas and oil and leaks and everything. But
you got a few minutes. Would you like to take a little ride in luxury for a change?
Okay. Maybe another time. Ask me what I do for a living.
What do you do for a living?
I'm in sales.
Really? What kind of sales do you do?
I sell real estate.
I'm Dave. What's your name, sir?
Claude.
Hey, Claude, can you see yourself in one of these and taking your clients out? Do you think taking your clients out to look at a property in something like this, they would have a better image of you rather than this truck. You don't take your clients out in this truck, do you?
Well, I do, and some people, I don't know. Do you think it hurts my sales driving in an old rust bucket pickup truck?
I don't know. Do they like that spring sticking up in the middle there when the wife is sitting in the middle?
It's funny you said that. Some people have complained about that. Yeah. One guy had ripped his pants. Another guy I had to take to the hospital because there was a inappropriate puncture.
Open the door to this lovely SUV and take a smell of this brand new leather.
Oh, it smells wonderful.
Isn't that the greatest smell, that new car smell?
Okay.
Instead of smelling like hay.
Just a quick timeout. What's one of the most emotional things you can do to get somebody emotional? What's the one thing you can talk about? You were on it. You started for a while there and then you kind of drifted off. I want you to get back to go ahead. Somebody else want to take over? Lou, I think you're dying to jump. Or Alan?
I'll give it a shot. Claude, just imagine for a moment that the first moment you pull up to your client to pick them up to look at property, that you've already secured your credibility as somebody that's a successful, high performing top earner at your brokerage group. I mean, what would that do to your sales? Would it propel it or keep it flat, or what do you think it'll do?
You know, it's kind of funny. The top sales guys in my organization, they all drive really nice cars.
You think
the car would make a difference?
I mean, you've seen it for yourselves, what they drive. I mean, what do you think? What will that allow you to do?
I don't know. I mean, I work really hard. I love showing homes and everything, and I pick up the clients and drive them around. You think if I a nicer car, that wouldn't increase my sales, would it? Would it change my image or something like that?
I mean, not only will it increase your sales, it might put you at the President's Club. I mean, that's not something you're trying to attain this year, is it?
Imagine for a moment. Go ahead.
Okay. Imagine for a moment, like, you know, that not only does it increase your sales, but also puts you at the top of the President's Club. That's not something you're trying to attain this year, is it?
You know, it's exactly my goal for this year, to double my sales. And you think the car can make a big difference. I think you're right. Now be assertive and tell me I'm going to get this car. Just say, Claude, you've made a decision. Now close.
I've made the decision. I want you to double your sales. I want you to be sitting at the top at the President's Club. I want you to go to Maui this year. And I want you to look at everyone else in the eye and tell them that, hey, listen, there's one more spot here at the President's Club, and that's for me. What would you want to do next today with this car?
I've never bought a car like this before. What do I need to do? Do I have to sign something? Or?
That's a great question. All we would need is $5,000 down today, and we could finance the rest, and off you go to your next client appointment. I'm sure you have one today, right, since you're a very top-performing salesman, right?
Okay, good. I like that one. Is there a place to be assertive? You did a great job, all of you. Is there a time when you're negotiating with someone to be assertive, to say, you know what? I've made a decision. This is what we're going to do. Or you can say no to me, don't worry about it. But you said you wanted to increase your sales and you did all those little meets and greets really well. And you made it emotional. Okay. And boom, that when people see value in the product or service that you're selling, how much easier is it?
Everything.
It's everything. They have to see the value. Sales is so complicated when you think about it, right? You're dealing with a total stranger. You want them to like you. Of course, you want them to trust you. You have to make them emotional about your product or service, and then get them intellectually. Is it something they can afford, something they need or want? And you try to do this in the first meeting, the first phone call. Is this a skill set that's invaluable?
Absolutely.
It's amazing, but it's not easy, is it? I mean, these are tough role plays, firewalking, getting in to see Warren Buffett, Elon selling Elon Musk to turn on his satellites. I mean, you think about it, all these different scenarios. It's all the same. You know, what's the funny thing? It's all the same. It doesn't matter if it's real estate or any kind of product or service. Can you persuade another person to like you, trust you, and want to do business with you immediately? How powerful a skill set is that?
$9.
Yeah. And a few people, you know, I've been reading books about successful people, and all my life I've met some very successful people, and they have this ability to be very relaxed, very confident, and to commute and ask the right questions and engage total strangers in conversation and make them curious or get interested and motivated. It's a real skill that we should all work at. Hey, thank you everybody for coming today. I really appreciate
thank you.
It. I put you all up. Was I too hard on everybody there? I think I was a little
tough. Great practice.
Today.
I love it.
Woo-hoo.
We appreciate it.
The thing is, if we can do it here in practice and then go out in the real world, what'll happen, right? We'll go to the bank.
Does the house smell like corned beef and cabbage?
Yes. Yeah, we got this a giant crock pot. It's
Lux.
We're making this, we're having the family over tonight. It's my mother-in-law's 95th birthday.
Oh, wow.
And we're having all the family over and everything. And I figured, it's a cold, rainy North Carolina day. What's better than a crock pot corned beef and cabbage dinner?
Got any Girl Scout cookies, Claude?
No. Are you selling them?
He's still eating Rebecca's cookies in the garage.
My home still smells like Thin Mints from the Girl Scouts. I cannot say no to a Girl Scout, a cute Girl Scout in front of the Vons supermarket. Or in Joseph and Helen, in your case, it's a Harris Teeter, right?
Yes, Harris Teeter.
Is that the greatest? I love Harris Teeter. I think that's the most wonderful supermarket in the world. I love it. It's expensive, but it's better than Whole Foods or Trader Joe's. It's a supermarket. They have a whole wine department. They got a gigantic cheese department. They got a barbecue ribs on little kiosks and chickens and things. Have you guys ever been to one of those stores before?
No.
It's called Harris Tea. It's an amazing store. I really enjoy it. Listen, now you guys made me hungry. I'm sorry. I'll see you all later, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Enjoy your stay. Have a great time in your North Carolina.
Thank you. Take care.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.